Saga Egmont presents The Housewife by Alex Kane, read by Cathleen McCarron. For my grandpa, who never got to see me become a writer. He'd have read every word if he was here, and I'd have been blushing in the corner. For my dad, this book is released on your 65th birthday. Happy birthday. Prologue. The ground was cold, the soil wet, the hole deep. Scrambling, she managed to get to her feet, and she ran faster than she thought her legs could carry her. But now she was on the ground, a blunt force shunting her forward. He spun her around and she was facing upwards. Her sight was blurry, her head throbbing, but she could see the sky by peering through the tops of the trees as she was pulled by the feet back towards her own grave. She'd almost got away, almost made it to safety, but he was too quick for her. He was determined to make her pay. She was falling now, into a black hole. Soil and thick clumps of dirt were beginning to pile on top of her. Blinking away tears and dirt that scratched her eyes, the woman tried to open her mouth to speak, to plead with her killer not to do this. As the dirt piled on heavy, weighing her down, the darkness began to creep in. 1. He questioned how he would do it. A knife to the throat? A bullet through the skull? Those were the two methods he preferred, and the way the hard men of Glasgow put their rivals in the ground. But which would be the best and most enjoyable way to kill Frankie Conway? Terry Reid, Glasgow's most notorious gangster, asked himself that very question on the morning he chose the second option and shot Frankie Conway, his drug-dealing rival. But drugs weren't the reason Terry put a bullet through Frankie's skull. Of course, he'd been thinking about ending the fucker for a long time, but he'd been presented with evidence that had given him the perfect excuse to finally go through with it. Richie Jackson, Terry's right-hand man and business partner, had been in the driving seat of the car, waiting for Terry to give the go-ahead. Once they'd finally tracked Frankie down, it was game on. The sun shone, and the air was particularly warm in Glasgow that early spring Sunday morning. Frankie had been walking past the park in Govan Hill when Richie drew up. But Frankie wasn't alone. He was with one of his so-called bodyguards. A man like Frankie needed a babysitter. He was one for pissing off too many of Glasgow's businessmen, and it was only a matter of time before someone took him out. Turning in response to the approaching car, Frankie Conway had looked Terry Reid in the eye as he shot him 3 times in the head. He'd gone down fast, landing in a pool of his own blood, before Terry turned the gun on Frankie's guard and shot him too. It was nothing personal against the guy, just business. He had to take out the witness. It was then that Richie sped off. It was early enough that no one else was around. Even if they were, Frankie Conway was the type of lowlife people wouldn't miss in the area. And Terry Reid was the type that no one would speak against, so he was confident that there would be no connection.
"The bastard deserved everything he got," Richie said, as he drove through the Clyde Tunnel back onto their side of Glasgow, their own home territory. "The shit he got away with over the years. I heard the guy owed him money for a bit of coke and he couldn't pay, so he smashed him over the head with a bat and removed his eye. The guy was found days later on the disused railway with his eye in his jacket pocket. And that's just a recent story. Frankie Conway was a fucking nutjob."
"Aye, well, he's paid the price now. I wasn't having him going around telling stories about Cora and making me look like a fucking idiot."
Richie laughed. What the fuck was Cora thinking being anywhere near him?
No idea, mate, Terry said, wondering the same thing.
He'd seen the camera footage of the night in question. How she thought she would get away with it was ridiculous. What is it they say? Never shit on your own doorstep. That was what Cora had done, getting involved with Conway on Terry's property when he was out of the country. Terry was quiet now, thinking about how he was going to approach the subject with Cora. It had been rumours initially, and that was bad enough. But now that Terry had hard evidence that Frankie and Cora had been at it behind his back, there was only one outcome.
What are you going to say to her?
Richie asked as he pulled into Terry's drive.
I don't know, mate.
Just stay calm, eh? I know what you can get like.
Terry raised a brow. He hadn't told Richie about the club CCTV images, or the fact that the staff on the night were quick to tell Terry what they'd seen. He knew what Cora was like, and given that she was married when Terry had met her, he shouldn't have been surprised when he saw his missus pressed up against a wall in his club with Frankie at her back. If anything, he was impressed by the sheer audacity and blatant disregard for the fact that they would get caught eventually.
I'll see you later on, eh?
Terry said as he got out the car.
Terry, just don't do anything stupid, eh? I don't want a trip to that pig farm down Helensburgh way. We've enough to deal with.
Richie smiled sarcastically at him before Terry closed the door. Govan Hill would be swarming with police now, Terry thought as he walked through the front door of his home and into the path of his fiancée, Cora Anderson. As she laid a kiss on his mouth like she always did when he arrived home, it was all he could do not to knock her head off her shoulders. But that wouldn't get him answers. Not that he expected Cora to tell the truth. It seemed she wasn't capable. Terry remembered when he was the other man and how complicated things had become when Cora left her husband. Normally, Terry couldn't be bothered with baggage, but he had fallen hard and fast for Cora. It had always been his way. Always. Cora Anderson had it all with Terry. A fancy big house with a pool, all the designer bags and shoes a woman could hope for. No need to go out and be a slave to the monthly wage like she had with her previous husband. He wished Richie had been right. Why would Cora go near someone like Conway when she had Terry at home? But she had. And it was killing Terry to think of Cora like that.
You seem tense. Can I do anything to help?
Cora suggested, allowing her silk dressing gown to slip off her shoulders, bearing smooth, tanned skin. He allowed her lips to run over his neck. She knew what she was doing, keeping him on side. But it felt good. That was what Cora was good at, making men feel good about themselves. Shame she felt the need to be that way with Frankie. As she kissed him and ran her hand down to his crotch, Terry reached for the whiskey bottle on the counter and opened it. Cora didn't seem to notice. Terry gulped back two large mouthfuls before tucking his finger under her chin, lifting Cora's face to meet his.
I never asked you how your girl's night out went. A good night, was it?
He said, his lips millimetres from hers. He could taste her, feel her heart beating against him. He loved her. He hated her. The betrayal she committed on the edge of his tongue.
Yeah, it was a laugh. Nothing like being at home with you, though, she replied, unzipping his trousers.
Terry closed his eyes and wanted to let go. Wanted to forget what he saw on that footage. The last time she was this intimate with someone, it was Frankie.
Is that right?
He looked deep into her eyes and could see his reflection in them.
He wanted her, but not like this. He wasn't the idiot she thought he was, and she certainly couldn't fool him into bed so he would believe that she was an innocent, well-behaved little fiancé. He knew fine well she was the very opposite of that.
Yes. And, you know, I was thinking we could go out and start looking at wedding venues next week. There's this beautiful place in...
Her words trailed off as Terry took hold of her wrists, just as her hand reached inside his trousers.
Ouch, Terry! What the hell are you doing?
She cried out as she tried to pull away.
What? You don't like it rough? Surely you must if you were able to open your legs for that bastard Conway.
Terry's voice boomed, bouncing off the walls surrounding them. Cora's eyes filled with terror as they bored into Terry's.
What the fuck is that supposed to mean?
Letting go of her wrist, Terry turned his back to her and gulped from the bottle again. The hairs on the back of his neck stood on end as he thought about what Richie had told him just a week earlier.
I've heard around that Cora slept with Frankie Conway. He's been boasting about it around the clubs. He said that she mustn't be getting a lot from Big Tezza, or she wouldn't have opened her legs to him. He needs bringing down a peg or two, Terry. He's saying it happened in one of your clubs.
It means Frankie has had a lot to say about you, and I want to hear it from your end, Cora. And don't fucking bullshit me. I'm not in the mood to be lied to.
Cora straightened her back, and her expression turned to cold. From the look he saw on her face, Terry didn't know what was going to come out of her mouth next.
Right. I didn't want to tell you because I knew you'd go off your nut, but I was out with the girls a few weeks ago. It was a Thursday to Sunday session, you know how it is. You were down south securing that deal for Reed Construction. It's not like I didn't tell you I was out when you phoned.
Cora stopped, as if expecting Terry to have something to say. When he didn't say anything, she continued.
We went to a couple of your clubs. We were drinking, had a couple of lines. You know what it's like when us girls get going. Then Frankie appeared out of nowhere. He was trying it on with me, but I kept knocking him back. He was trying it on with all of us, buying rounds of drinks and that.
It was amazing how good a liar Cora was. But then he couldn't expect anything less of her, considering how they got together themselves. They'd met in a bar in the city centre. She'd been on a night out with the girls. Cora had fluttered her eyes at him from across the room, and Terry felt a stir within that he'd never felt for anyone before. He saw the wedding band on her finger, but bought her a drink anyway. By the end of the night, she was back at his, and they'd had sex in almost every room. It wasn't long after that she left her husband. Cora was like a drug to Terry, something he couldn't live without. But like most drugs, the high wears off and soon becomes a bad habit. He should have known she would do this. Slamming his hand on the counter, Terry stared deeply at Cora. She didn't blink, held his gaze. He'd had enough.
Cora.
Terry took a steadying breath.
Why was Frankie Conway going around telling people he shagged you in one of my clubs?
Terry bellowed and Cora jumped.
Don't stand there and fucking lie to me. You think I haven't seen the camera footage of you? Skirt up your arse, tits hanging out.
Cora shook her head and sneered.
Don't you bloody dare insinuate that I wanted him to be all over me.
I don't have to insinuate anything, Cora. It's there in black and fucking white. You shagged him, didn't you? In my club. He had you up against the wall at the door next to the stockroom and you were fucking loving it.
Cora turned her back on Terry, and for a moment he felt like he couldn't breathe. How could she do this? Why would she think Frankie Conway was a better option? He was a nobody,
a street boy who wanted to play with the gangsters. Thanks to Cora, he'd ended up with a bullet in his head.
Terry,
Cora started, her voice meek.
You're never here.
How stupid are you, Cora? To do that on my property, it's like you wanted to get fucking caught,
Terry said, gripping the edge of the sink until his knuckles were white.
Or is that how you like it? The thrill of knowing that I would find out at some point? Is that what it was like at the start with us? Did you want your husband to catch us? Do you get off on that?
Cora didn't respond. What else was there for her to say? Terry knew right away that she had ruined everything that he'd had to offer her. A few moments of silence passed before Cora said,
I don't know what I was thinking.
A white-hot, blinding light fell across Terry's vision as he pushed himself off the sink and flew at Cora. Gripping her by the throat, he crushed so hard he thought his fingers might pierce her skin. Her eyes bulged from her head as she tried to fight him. Cora pulled at Terry's fingers as she fought for breath. He couldn't look at her, not while he was squeezing every breath out of her body. She deserved this as much as Frankie did. They could both rot in hell for all Terry cared. He wasn't one to be made a fool of, not a chance.
You did this, Cora. Not me. You.
A few seconds later, Terry let go and Cora dropped to the floor. Stepping away from her, he pulled out his phone and called Richie. But just as the phone rang at the end of the line, Richie stepped into the hallway and stared down at Cora's body.
Jesus, Terry! What the fuck? Mate, I need you to take care of something for me,
Terry said.
I thought I told you not to do anything stupid,
Richie said, glaring up at Terry.
Aye, well, things didn't quite pan out like that. I need you to get rid of her. Can you do that?
Blowing air out from his mouth, Richie ran a hand over the top of his head.
Consider it done,
Richie replied, placing a hand on Terry's shoulder.
But did it really have to come to this? I don't want your opinion. Just do this for me, please.
Terry stepped over Cora's body and headed straight for his club. He needed to get away. It was one thing to kill his fiancée, it was another to dispose of her. That was why he had a team. Slouched on the office chair in his casino and club, Terry Reed replayed the footage of Cora and Frankie over and over. It had happened right outside the stockroom, and it made him feel sick to think that not only had Cora done this to him, but that Frankie Conway had laughed about it with his street player mates. Swigging back on the whiskey bottle, and having had enough of watching the betrayal committed by his fiancée, he hit the delete button on the system. There was no way he was going to allow anyone to say he'd had motive for what happened to Cora. None at all. The door to the office opened, and Richie Jackson appeared, concern etched in his expression.
You all right? Fucking dandy, mate,
Terry replied, taking another drink.
Job done?
Aye, she's well and truly hidden. You've nothing to worry about, mate. It's all sorted. I'm surprised to see you here, though.
Terry readjusted his position on the chair, almost losing his balance as it spun under his weight.
Didn't know where else to go. I mean, where do you go after you've murdered your cheating bitch of a fiancé? And I was deleting that fucking shit.
He nodded at the screen.
You've actually watched it?
Richie asked, entering the office and perching himself on the edge of the desk.
Aye, not without difficulty. It's one thing to know your missus slept with one of your rivals, but to have it on tape and actually see it happen is something else entirely,
Terry replied, slamming the bottle of malt on the desk as he got to his feet.
When you asked her, before, you know, what did she say?
She admitted it, but put the blame on me, saying I was never home.
Fuck, Richie exhaled. I didn't think you'd do what you did, mate. Was killing that scumbag Frankie not enough?
Terry moved towards the door, hovered there for a moment. Richie Jackson had been his best mate for years, even when they were just street players themselves from the old Main Hill estate. But he didn't like being questioned on decisions he made or what he'd done, even by Richie. He thought about how he'd wrapped his fingers around Cora's neck and strangled her. Seeing the light leave her eyes was bad enough, but having his best mate dig him up about it made it worse.
You're supposed to be on my side, Terry sneered.
Of course I'm on your side, that's why I'm asking. We don't want a higher body count than necessary, that's all.
Terry shook his head.
Then she shouldn't have wronged me, Richie. Fuck me over, and you pay for it. You know who I am and how I work. If you don't like it...
I didn't say I didn't like it. I'm just thinking what's best for you. You don't tend to get stressed, and I don't want this to affect your head.
Richie's concerned expression grew. Terry knew his mate meant well. Of course he did. He'd gotten rid of the body, sorted Frankie out with him. He helped run the organisation with him. There wasn't a bad or negative bone in Richie's body in relation to Terry or the work he did, the decisions he made.
I know you don't, and it won't. Cora was dead to me the moment I found out what she'd been up to. Now she really is, and I can get on with things. Speaking of getting on with things, I'm going to head home. It's been a bit of a shitty day. Need to get my head down.
Need me to drive you home? Richie asked.
Terry could tell by the look on his face that he was worried. But he needn't be. Terry had committed far worse crimes over the years than kill his fiancée for shagging someone else. He was Terry fucking Reed, and it would take a lot more than a slag like Cora Anderson to bring him down.
2.
Glancing down at the little stick she held in her hand, Maisie Whitelaw held in her sobs as it confirmed what she'd dreaded. She was pregnant. She'd just turned 16 the previous day, and Maisie knew that her life was over. Not that it had ever begun. No one had a life if they were brought up in Main Hill Estate. The place was like hell on earth. If you were born into it, there was no getting out. Wrapping the stick in some tissue, Maisie flushed the toilet and shoved the test into the pocket of her jeans. What was she going to do now? She couldn't tell her mum for two reasons. One, she'd probably slap her, but only if she was sober. She was a callous, cold bitch, was Rosie Whitelaw. Or two, she'd be too off her face to even comprehend that Maisie was standing in front of her. And she couldn't very well tell the dad. He wouldn't be interested. All he'd wanted from Maisie was sex. He'd made that clear from the beginning, 6 months earlier. He was older than her by 4 years and a friend of her brother Freddie's. How would Freddie react to the news when he didn't even know she'd been sleeping with Galzo in the first place? Taking a deep breath, Maisie Whitelaw stepped out of the bathroom and into the hallway. The house she shared with her parents and two brothers was disgusting. She'd hated it from the moment she could understand it. Dark, damp, and dingy. All Rosie and Maisie's dad, Cammy, cared about was where the next bag or can was coming from. Not that Maisie was any better. She'd dabbled in all sorts as soon as she'd started seeing Galzo 6 months ago. She would have done anything to keep him close, and she did. She slept with him just days into meeting him. Silly little girl, she thought. Now look what's happened. She'd started off smoking a bit of weed. She'd even done that when she was younger, before she'd met Galzo.
It wasn't hard to get hold of the stuff when it was lying around the house all the time. Then she'd gone on to smoking it all the time, along with normal cigarettes. Then, one night at a party in one of the flats on the estate, she and Galzo had been in one of the bedrooms and he'd offered her a pill. He'd made it sound exciting, like it would be the best ride of her life. Maisie didn't even know what it was and didn't bother to ask. All she cared about was the fact that Galzo was spending time on her. So she'd taken it. The trip was horrible. She felt like she was constantly falling from a great height, and the paranoia she'd been left with the next day was awful. It was 5 months ago that she'd tried heroin for the first time. She'd loved it. It was far better than the pill she'd taken. And now she was on the methadone programme because her brother Lee had pretty much dragged her to the GP to get her help. Maisie was shocked at how quickly she'd become addicted. Lee Whitelaw had grilled her on who had given her the drugs, but she'd refused to tell him. All she'd said was it had been a guy she was seeing, but there was no way she would tell Lee it was Galzo. He'd kill him if he knew. Thankfully, he'd backed off, but Lee had been keeping an eye on her ever since. Now she was pregnant and trying to stay clean. What kind of life would that be for a baby to be born into? No, she'd have to get rid of it. There was no other choice. But the thought of going through that process terrified her more than the prospect of becoming a mother at 16.
You are right there, Maisie. You look like shit, her dad said as she passed him on her way to the front door.
Aye, cheers for that one, da.
Slamming the door behind her, Maisie walked down the stairs and over to the centre of the estate. And there he was, the love of her life. With his arm around another girl, one of her so-called mates. Galzo glanced across at her. She went to smile, but before she could, he turned away from Maisie and planted a kiss on the girl's lips right in front of her. Maisie's heart lurched in her chest. There was no way she could keep this baby. Looking down at it every day would remind her of her shitty relationship with Galzo, if she could even call it a relationship. He'd never been the type of guy to stick to one girl, and Maisie had been stupid enough to believe that she could be the one to change him. Maisie made her way along the street, away from the display of affection between Galzo and her so-called mate, and she bit down on her lip as she tried not to cry. The growing lump in her throat ached, and when she saw her big brother Lee walking towards her, the tears came in waves.
What's wrong?
Lee said, as she almost collapsed into his arms. Lee, her older brother by 6 years, was the one who'd cared for her the most when she'd been little, because Rosie and Cammy were too busy taking drugs and drinking their way through her childhood. She trusted him the most out of everyone in her life. Lee would know what to do in this situation. He was the only smart one of the family, the one who had managed to keep them all fed and with a roof over their heads.
I'm pregnant.
The look on his face made her feel shame and disgust at her own actions. How could she have been so stupid? Lee was angry with her, but that wouldn't last forever. He'd want to break the legs of the guy who'd got her into this situation in the first place.
Maisie, how could you be so bloody stupid?
She let out a sob and Lee sighed as he pulled her close.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean that. Do you know who the dad is?
Of course I do. What the hell do you take me for, Lee? I might be stupid, but I'm no slapper.
You need to tell me who the dad is, Maisie. He needs to know he has a responsibility.
Pulling away from her brother, Maisie looked back at where Galzo had been standing. If she told Lee, she'd be responsible for ultimately causing Galzo's death, because Lee would kill him when he found out. Shaking her head, she faced her brother.
If I tell you, you have to promise to stay calm and keep this to yourself, because it could cause a war if it got out.
Lee stared down at Maisie and suddenly she felt sick, As she explained everything, she hoped that he wouldn't betray her trust and expose Galzo. The truth of the matter was, she was underage when she'd started seeing him. No one liked that kind of thing around Mainhill, but it had been her choice. She'd loved him from that first night, and her feelings had only grown stronger.
"If you lose your shit, Lee, you'll only be hurting me,"
Maisie said at the end.
"You were 15 when you started seeing him. That makes him a fucking pervert, Maze. And he's taking the piss because he's mates with Freddy. How the hell did you manage to get involved with someone like him?"
"Lee, I ask myself that every day. But I love him."
"You love him, but you don't want him to know you're carrying his baby. Sounds like the perfect relationship to me."
Maisie wiped at the tears that were dripping from her nose.
"Don't be angry with me," she said. "I didn't plan for this. I was concentrating on getting better. The meth programme was working. I had no idea I was even pregnant."
Maisie knew that wasn't strictly true. She'd missed 3 periods in a row, but she was too terrified to take a test. It wasn't until she'd noticed how she was struggling to do up her jeans that she'd decided to find out for sure. No one in the house had seemed to notice, and why would they when they were on another planet half the time?
"What are you going to do?"
Lee asked.
"I've no idea,"
Maisie replied. It was true. She knew keeping the baby wasn't a good solution. But now that she knew Galzo's baby was growing inside her, it meant that she would always have a piece of him. Glancing back down the street, Maisie blinked away tears as she watched Galzo get into his truck and drive out of the estate. 3. 6 months later. Lee and Freddie Whitelaw stepped into the shop with caution and glanced over at the man behind the counter. It seemed there was no one else inside, just the 3 of them. Lee almost felt guilty. Almost. But Freddie had fucked up and they needed quick cash. The blade up Lee Whitelaw's sleeve was cool against his arm. Beads of sweat formed on his brow and the back of his neck. He watched as Freddie pulled his balaclava down over his face and moved towards the counter. Lee waited, as planned. If Freddie couldn't get what he needed, that was when Lee would step in. He didn't want to use a blade, didn't even want to threaten the man with it. He wasn't like Freddie. He wasn't as scummy as the rest of the family, or the rest of the people on the estate. But he wasn't going to stand back and watch his brother make an arse of the situation if he didn't have to.
"Right, open the till and give me what's inside,"
Lee heard Freddie say. He sounded surprisingly calm, but it didn't last long when the man resisted.
"I said, open the till, you fucking idiot, or I'll fucking cut you."
The words threw Lee into action, and he too pulled his own balaclava over his face and moved towards the counter. As he approached, he saw terror in the man's eyes. Lee couldn't help but wonder why he would ever choose to do a shift in a shop in the middle of Main Hill on his own, knowing what the place and the people were like.
"Do as he said,"
Lee warned, allowing the blade to slide out from its hiding place. Holding it outright at the shopkeeper, Lee felt nausea setting in. He kept hoping for the man to spring into action and hand over the money in the till. He didn't want to have to slice the man open. It would bring more aggravation than he needed right now. It was bad enough, the situation they were in. Murder or attempted murder was not on the cards. The man calmly pressed a button to release the till drawer and then stood back.
"Help yourselves."
Lee frowned under his balaclava as Freddie leapt across the counter and started filling the bag with the cash from inside. Lee kept the blade up, pointed at the shopkeeper.
"Hurry the fuck up, would you?" "Got it,"
Freddie replied, sliding himself back across and onto the shop floor. As they made their way out quickly, Freddie pulled down one of the stands and a selection of sweets and newspapers fell onto the floor.
Huh, fuck you, you bastard!
Freddie shouted as he waved the bag of stolen cash in the air. Lee pulled him onto the street and they ran down the hill towards the centre of the estate where they lived. Lee still had the blade in his hand as they rushed along the pavement, then weaved in and out of the derelict garages which stood behind the row of council flats. A group of drunk teenagers cheered them on, waving bottles of Buckfast in the air and jumping around excitedly. Lee ignored them and kept moving towards the centre of the estate, the most notorious part of Main Hill. Freddie, on the other hand, swung the bag of cash above his head and laughed along with them. If Lee wanted to plug anyone right now, it would be his brother. It was as if Freddie wanted them to get caught. He wasn't thinking of the bigger picture at all, and that was dangerous for not just Lee and Freddie, but for the whole family. Approaching the stairs which led to the council house they shared with the rest of the Whitelaws, Lee and Freddie took them two at a time. Freddie was inside first, hunched over and sucking in great lungfuls of air and laughing at the same time.
Quick, shut the fucking door!
Freddie hissed at Lee, pulling off the balaclava and revealing his acne-scarred face.
Do you think we're good?
Lee said as he locked the door, trying not to show his frustration. Freddie peered out of the side window and down the stairs towards the street, his chest heaving as he gulped in air.
Aye, we're good. Do you think anyone would be stupid enough to come after us, knowing you had a blade on you?
Freddie moved away from the window and leaned over, placing his hands on his knees as he tried to catch his breath. Lee stared at Freddie before sliding down the wall. He sat down on the floor behind the front door and removed his own balaclava before wiping the back of his hand over his forehead. Beads of sweat trickled down his face as he too tried to catch his breath.
Are you no right in the head or something?
Lee said, jabbing a finger at Freddie, still holding the blade in his other hand.
What the fuck was all that about? Swinging the bag at those wee fuckers down on the street? Do you want us to get fucking caught? Oi, we live in Main Hill. It's no like they'll grass on us, is it? That group down there want to be like us, Lee. Stop your bloody whinging,
Freddie mocked. Lee removed his balaclava, took another breath and considered what Freddie had said. He was right, as much as it annoyed Lee. Those boys down there would eventually grow into becoming just like Lee and Freddie. A vicious circle of living in Main Hill.
How much did we manage to get? Lee asked. I dunno, Lee. I didn't exactly stop to fucking count while you held a blade up to him.
Freddie replied as he dropped the bag to the floor and opened it.
Bastard thought he was getting sliced open. Did you see his face? Priceless.
Lee Whitelaw hid his disgust at how much Freddie enjoyed other people's misery. That was where they differed considerably. He leaned forward as Freddie emptied the contents of the bag onto the floor. They'd managed to pull the entire contents of the shop till in their heist. Lee's eyes widened as Freddie counted out the cash.
372 quid,
Freddie smiled.
That should keep us going for a while, eh, bro?
He nudged Lee with the shoulder and a grin spread across his face.
Nah, that's going straight to the debt we owe,
Lee replied. As much as Lee liked to smoke and a line every now and then, he was nowhere near as bad as his brother. If Freddie wasn't careful, he'd be on the heavier shit soon enough. No matter how bad things got, Lee always promised himself he'd stay clear of that stuff. Once was enough to get you hooked.
Fuck the debt, Lee,
Freddie sneered as he began to shove the cash back into the bag. Lee shook his head and got to his feet along with Freddie, and they moved through the hall towards the kitchen where their mum was standing at the counter with a mug in her hand, looking a little worse for wear. Barely standing, Lee thought, as he stared at the woman who called herself a mum. She was half swaying, half leaning against the worktop. The kitchen was dark and dingy. Nicotine-stained wallpaper hung off the walls in tears and strips, and the blind on the window barely held on with one screw. A cloud of smoke floated above their heads, clinging to the pulley dangling above their head. Not that there was clean laundry hanging on it. There were never clean clothes or bedsheets. They were lucky to have both of those things at all, never mind clean ones. That wasn't one of Rosie's priorities. Heroin, booze and cigarettes were the things that drove her, and even then she could barely get out of bed to source those things. That was a job for Lee and Freddie.
All right, boys.
Rosie Whitelaw slurred, her eyes almost rolling to the back of her head. Lee Whitelaw shook his head. He knew her claims of getting clean were bullshit. He'd heard it his whole life and had stopped hoping a long time ago.
Nice to see you sober for once more.
Freddie shot Lee a look. He didn't want Rosie to clock the bag of cash they had on them. She would only spend it all on herself.
What are you doing?
She asked, her eyes now almost completely shut. Her speech was slow, barely audible. She hadn't even heard Lee's dig.
Nothing more,
Freddie replied. Rosie Whitelaw would have been a looker back in her day if she hadn't allowed the drugs to get a grip of her. Lee knew that Freddie would eventually become the same thing. Nothing but a junkie. That was exactly what Lee didn't want to become. Having grown up around that kind of lifestyle and seeing what it had done to his parents had made him determined to get away from Main Hill and live some kind of normality. Freddie gestured towards the hallway and Lee made a move upstairs. Freddie was right to want the money out of Rosie's way, but they would have to be careful. That old man was upstairs, and if he saw the money, he too would likely nick it and spend it on himself. Drugs, of course, just like Rosie. It was a wonder they weren't dead already. In fact, Lee often wondered if it wasn't the drugs that were keeping them alive. Without them, they'd probably die from withdrawal. Freddie went inside his bedroom and Lee followed. This was the only room in the house which possessed carpet. Not that it was luxurious by any means. It didn't even fit the space properly and was littered with stains from over the years. Taking socks and shoes off wasn't an option. The rest of the floors in the council house were covered in flattened cardboard boxes. Growing up in the Main Hill estate, Freddie and Lee had come to learn that most of the families who lived there were the same as them. Druggies for parents, although the Whitelaws seemed to be the only family left with a full set. Cardboard boxes acting as carpets. Boarded up windows and overgrown grass surrounding the council houses and flats were the defining features of the Main Hill estate. It wasn't unusual to see kids aged around 10 smoking and drinking in the street now that Freddie and Lee were older. It seemed as time went on, Main Hill got worse. And if you didn't live in Main Hill, you didn't venture in. Except for the dealers, who made a living off other people's misery and addictions. Just as Lee was about to close the bedroom door, he stopped and listened. Cammy Whitelaw was snoring like a bull.
Don't wake Da, Freddie whispered.
Lee closed the door quietly and slid the bolt across to secure it.
He'll only pocket the cash when her back is turned.
Turning, Freddie was already emptying the bag onto the bed again. 372 quid was a lot of money for people like the Whitelaws. It would mean some food, and most of all, drugs. But Lee knew that this money had to go to debt, without question. A mobile phone started ringing in Freddie's pocket and he pulled it out. By the look on his face, Lee knew who was calling his brother.
It's them.
Freddy glared at the phone and then at Lee. Lee held out his hand and Freddy gave him the phone.
Let me deal with this, Fred. No offence, but you're not the brightest of sparks. You'll end up in deeper shit if you try to fix this. Don't answer it, Freddy said. Freddy, Terry Reed isn't fucking stupid. He knows where you live. If we keep ignoring him, he'll just send some of his heavies round. Do you want to end up at the bottom of the fucking canal, mate? Because you know that's what will happen if you don't pay up.
Freddy sighed heavily.
We owe them 300. That won't leave nearly enough for what we need. You're as well giving them the fucking law.
First of all, we don't owe him anything. This is all down to you. But I'm not going to let you get killed for a couple hundred quid, Lee said. His thumb hovered over the answer button, and he hit it before even he changed his mind. Hello? Freddy stared at Lee with bundles of notes between his fingers.
Aye, Richie. Nae bother, mate. Got it ready and waiting. Aye, right. We'll meet you outside in half an hour.
Lee knew it was bad when Richie Jackson had said he was coming to get the money himself. He and Terry weren't ones for coming into Main Hill themselves unless they absolutely had to. Lee worried that this could mean the worst.
Shit! Freddy exclaimed. Well fucking done, bro. You've just lost us a good few gram of coke right there.
Shoving Freddy's phone into his pocket, he ignored his brother and reached for the cash. Counting out the amount they owed to the Reeds, Lee opened the bedroom door and headed for the front door. This day was going from bad to worse.
Oi! Lee, you fucking prick!
Freddy called after Lee, who was ignoring him as he reached the front door.
What the fuck's all the racket?
Cammy Whitelaw shouted from the bedroom upstairs. Lee was outside and moved down the concrete steps to the street. He eyed the kids across the street, playing loudly outside the council flats. Women stood in their verandas, smoking and chatting to one another, and the group of young teenagers who Freddy had shown off to still stood on the corner of the circle where the Whitelaws lived, drinking bottles of cheap cider. Lee knew that as soon as Terry Reed's men drew up, everyone would either scarper or the estate would fall silent. Standing at the bottom of the stairs, Lee waited. It was ridiculous of Freddy to think they would get away with not paying Terry what they owed him. Terry wasn't a one-man show, and he ran the entire city. It would be unlikely that Terry himself would turn up with Richie, but if Lee and Freddy didn't pay up now, then it was a possibility. He could walk into the estate and shoot them dead in front of everyone, and not one person would say a word when the police came knocking. If the police came at all. It was the kind of place that if the police could avoid it, they would. Main Hill practically ran itself.
Oi!
Freddy shouted from the top of the stairs.
Are you fucking deaf?
Nah, Lee replied without turning to face his brother. But you're a fucking idiot.
Mate, we could hang off for a bit longer. We could double the money we've got in that bag and then pay off our debt.
Lee turned to Freddy, who was now standing by his side, looking flustered.
And how are you going to double the money? I don't know. Casino and that?
Lee burst into laughter in Freddy's face.
Like they let the likes of us into a casino, Lee scoffed.
And have you forgotten who owns the casinos in the city?
Aye, Terry Reed.
Like I said, you're a fucking idiot.
Look, Freddy, just leave me to sort this, eh? The Reeds are already gunning for you for trying to deal a bit of coke you bought off them. You're lucky I caught that Richie lad in a good mood, or you'll have ended up with two broken legs. Just fuck off now, eh? We'll sort out some more cash once I've dealt with this.
Freddy opened his mouth to reply, but thought better of it and disappeared back up the stairs towards the house.
Lee turned to face the street again when Maisie Whitelaw emerged from one of the flats. His pregnant sister was almost ready to drop and had moved into her own place just the previous day. He couldn't believe 6 months had passed by since she'd told him about the pregnancy. He recalled the conversation they'd had when she found out about the baby. She was certain she wasn't keeping it. But then she'd been for a scan, and when she heard the baby's heart, that had done it. Maisie had sobbed, said she didn't want to go through with the termination, so she didn't.
"How's things, sis?" Lee asked.
"Place is a fucking palace compared to that shithole up there," Maisie said. "But it's still a dump. Need to get some cash together and at least give it a lick of paint."
The closer Maisie approached, the more Lee could smell weed. It didn't seem to matter that she was growing a child in her belly. It still didn't stop her. Although he had to be grateful she was at least off the heroin. Lee gave her a tight-lipped smile.
"Maybe you should be asking that prick for some cash to help you set that place up for when the baby comes," Lee sneered, although the emotion wasn't directed at his sister.
"What are you doing out here?" she asked, ignoring his jibe.
It annoyed Lee that Maisie hadn't bothered to fight Galzo on the fact that she was having his child. He'd shown zero interest in her or the pregnancy. If it hadn't been for Maisie practically pleading with Lee not to, he'd have done him in by now.
"Waiting on someone?"
Lee replied, pushing Galzo's face out of his mind.
"The Reeds?" she pressed. "Freddy still owes them money?"
Lee nodded.
"Aye, so you best do one. Don't want you here when they turn up. Bad enough I'm having to involve myself because Fred couldn't finish something he started. I don't want you around when they get here."
Maisie barely acknowledged the concern in her brother's tone. Instead, she continued walking and headed up to the house.
"Ma and Dan?"
"Aye, although you'll not get much sense out Ma. She's off her face again."
Maisie sighed.
"Granny of the fucking year award coming up."
Lee closed his eyes and shifted his stance from one foot to the other, patting the lump of cash in his back pocket. The nerves were making his stomach lurch. The blade he'd used to threaten the shopkeeper earlier was still up his sleeve, so at least he had some way of defending himself if things got ugly. Lee hoped it wouldn't come to that. That was the last thing the Whitelaws needed, Lee slashing a bloody gangster. Around 20 minutes had passed when Lee heard the sound of a car turning into Main Hill. It didn't sound like the rickety pieces of shite he was used to hearing in the estate. There was a softer purr to the engine, a newer machine. Looking up, Lee saw the pristine Range Rover. Brand new, tinted windows, blinding shine. The vehicle's approach made Lee feel sick. The Range pulled up next to Lee and the back driver's side door opened.
"Where's Freddy?"
Richie Jackson asked. Lee stared into the car and felt his stomach drop at the sight of Terry Reed.
"He's away for a few days," Lee lied. "I said I'd take care of his debt."
"Oh, did you now? That wasn't your call to make,"
Terry replied from inside, without making eye contact with Lee.
"Get in,"
Richie said. Trying not to tremble with fear, Lee felt the blade of the knife up his sleeve nip his flesh as he climbed into the back of the car. Terry wasn't driving. He was in the passenger seat. Richie took them out of Main Hill, through the centre of town, and out to the town's substation grounds. Lee knew this wasn't a good thing. Terry Reed was clearly angry that payment was late.
"How are you doing, young Lee? Things going well?"
Terry said, sounding abnormally cheerful.
"Aye, good, Terry."
The Range stopped in the staff car park outside the substation. It was empty. Lee knew he was in trouble. Terry turned to face Lee as Richie got out of the car.
Good, you say. Word has it, you just knocked the till from your local newsagents. One of our properties. A lot of takings, were there?
Shit, shit, shit. Freddy and his bright fucking ideas.
Got anything to say about that, Lee? Terry, Mr. Reed, please.
Mr. Reed, I have your money right here. 300. I'm sorry it's late, but...
So, you're paying me with dirty money?
Terry said, just as Richie opened Lee's passenger door.
I don't take dirty money, Lee. You should know that by now.
Lee looked at Richie, who was gesturing for him to step out of the car. Lee did what he was told without words, and Terry got out of the car too.
Mr. Reed, Freddy Skin. He didn't have a choice,
Lee replied, trying to keep the desperation from his voice.
We just wanted to pay you back.
Terry glanced at Richie.
You know what, Richie? The White Laws have absolutely scunnered me over the last few months with their excuses.
Aye, me too, mate.
And now, Lee?
Terry's eyes fell upon Lee.
Can you take a guess at what is going to happen when I take that money off you?
Lee was silent, his eyes darting between the men in front of him. This is it, he thought. I'm dead because of my brother.
Terry continued. I'll have to go back to Mr. Stewart's shop and hand this money back to him and give him the additional 72 quid that you've left at home. That shop is his livelihood. And you and your thieving rat of a brother thought you'd be able to just take what you needed. Ever heard the expression, robbing Peter to pay Paul?
Mr. Reed,
Lee started, but Richie's already in his face.
Oi, shut your mouth and fucking listen.
The blade of the knife shifted inside Lee's sleeve. He could take it out, brandish it at them as a warning. But it would be stupid of him to do that. He was in the middle of nowhere, in a substation car park, face to face with Glasgow's biggest gangsters. He'd be dead within a second. And even if he did somehow manage to get away with doing something so stupid, he'd be on the run for the rest of his life. No wonder the shopkeeper had been so bloody calm, Lee thought. He'd have known fine well that the Reeds would sort this out.
Once you give the money back, you're going to apologise on behalf of you and that rat you call a brother. Then, you've got 3 days to find 300 quid plus 70% as a late payment charge.
Lee felt the bottom of his stomach almost fall out his arse. How the fuck was he supposed to find that amount of money? He didn't even know what 70% of 300 was off the top of his head, but he knew it was a lot more on top of what he already owed. Freddy was to blame for this. Leah tried to tell Freddy to pay the money back straight away, but Freddy thought he was fucking invincible these days.
They'll no come looking for me, bro. They've got bigger things to be getting on with.
Aye, killing folk like you who haven't bothered to pay what they owe. Lee had thought.
Oi, dream boy, is there anyone in there?
Richie shouted, knocking on Lee's head.
Do you get where we're coming from, Lee?
Aye, I get it.
The knife slipped down towards Lee's hand, but he didn't allow the blade to reveal itself from under the sleeve of his jumper.
Good, because I don't want to have to shoot you. Or that family of yours.
Young Maisie, she's due her baby soon, is she not?
Terry said. Lee saw a glint in his eye and knew not to push his luck.
I'll get your money, Terry. With the interest.
Lee replied, desperate to distract Terry from thoughts of his pregnant sister. Maisie was only 16. It wasn't her fault Freddie fucked up. And Lee was only doing what any brother would do for his family and trying to take control of the situation.
"In 3 days, mind," Richie said.
"Aye, in 3 days," Terry repeated.
Terry and Richie fell silent, and Lee wondered if this was it. They were just playing a sick game with him, making him think that they were going to give him another chance to get the money. Lee followed Terry's hands with his eyes as they moved inside his jacket. His heart banged against the wall of his chest, and Lee wanted to close his eyes. He took a deep breath as Terry produced a handgun, and a surge of adrenaline like electricity forced its way through Lee's body. Terry moved closer and held the gun to Lee's forehead, pressing hard into his skin. Shit, shit, shit. Lee stood perfectly still, like a frozen statue in the middle of the substation car park. He felt the vibration of the electricity humming in the cables above him.
"I don't normally conduct my business like this, Lee. I don't often come out to the streets to sort out the likes of you and your family. I've got dealers for that. But I've had enough of you lot taking a fucking piss. I don't take kindly to people thinking I'll just sit back while they try to fleece me. Luckily for you, Lee, I'm in a good mood, and I've got something else I need to deal with. So 3 days, or I blow you apart. Blow all of you apart. Got it?"
Lee nodded as Terry pulled the gun away and pushed it back inside his jacket. Terry and Richie backed away, an evil smile slithering across Richie's face. They got into the car and drove off, leaving him alone. The bastard gangsters. The fear weighing in Lee's belly dispersed along with the sound of the range in the distance. He looked out to the main road which led back to Main Hill and began walking. It would take around an hour if Lee walked at a good pace. But that was fine, because he was alive, and he hadn't expected to be at this point. "I'll fucking kill Freddy for this."
4. Glasgow was almost silent, illuminated by city lights and the full moon above them. As he stared up at the sky, he realised that tonight was the first night in 3 months that he had been able to think of Cora without picturing her with Frankie Conway. 6 months without Cora. It had felt more like 6 years. Glancing down at his hands, remembering the last time he'd touched her, his stomach clenched as he recalled that night. How her eyes bulged from their sockets. How he squeezed so hard he thought he might break her neck as life left her body. They'd been together for 2 years, engaged not long before that night. He thought she was the one. She'd left her husband for him, after all. Terry remembered wondering if he should have gotten involved with her, knowing that she was married. But Cora had a way about her. It was almost as though she'd cast a spell on him. Her name on his lips, her face in his mind, caused a stir.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.